بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Today we will have case quiz number 104. Case data: 42-year-old male, complaining of 3 months history of progressive proximal weakness and 15 kilogram weight loss. The patient had worsening dysphagia for solids. The patient was hospitalized 2 months earlier for respiratory failure, requiring intubation and 5 days of mechanical ventilation. Arterial blood gas on admission revealed BH of 7.26, BCO2 58.8, TOR bicarbonate 26.2, and BO2 of 57.1 TOR. A primary pulmonary etiology was not found and he was improved. During that hospitalization, an electromyogram EMG of the upper extremities was normal. There were chronic neurological changes in the lower extremities. The patient had also low amplitude, short duration motor unit potential, suggestive of myopathy were noted in the cervical and thoracic paraspinal muscles. The patient had past medical history of chronic low back pain, multiple lumbar surgeries, hypertension, glaucoma, and discoid lupus. The patient was maintained on hydroxychloroquine 1000 milligram per day, I mean 5 tablets of 200 milligram hydroxychloroquine per day for about 20 years for discoid lupus. So the patient is taking a very large dose of hydroxychloroquine for the treatment of discoid lupus, 1000 milligram per day. Examination. Neurological examination revealed Medical Research Council grade 4/5 strengths in the neck flexors and the proximal upper and lower extremity muscles. So, mild weakness of the upper and lower limbs and the neck flexors. The patient has distal muscle were strong. Tendon reflexes were diminished. Mild distal loss of sensation from the tooth to the ankle bilaterally. He was unable to rise from chair without using his hands. Investigations: CBC, ESR, thyroid functions, and electrolyte all were normal. CBK is high 509 and the normal is less than 200 international unit per liter. A repeat limited electromyogram immediately prior to deltoid needle muscle biopsy revealed mild fibrillation potential and positive wave activity along with short duration motor unit potentials in the proximal arm muscles. Hematocrit and eosine stain of the left deltoid muscle revealed an abnormal variation in myofiber size with a mild increase in internalized nuclei. Rare degeneration and occasional regenerating fibers were noted. Inflammatory infiltrate were not seen. Most fibers show multiple vacuoles containing granular amphiphilic material with the Gomori trichom stain. Purplish material was highlighted within the vacuoles and in the sarcoplasm. Oil red demonstrated lipid in some vacuoles. The material in the vacuoles were strongly reactive for acid, phosphate, and esterase. NADH, tetrazolium reductase reacted sections revealed a few small hyper-reactive fibers and targeted fibers. A BES stained section contained no abnormal accumulations of glycogen. Examination of thioflavin T and Congo red stains under fluorescence microscope revealed no abnormal accumulations. ATP's reacted section revealed loss of normal checkerboard pattern. Mild myofiber atrophy of both type 1 and type 2 fibers and vacuoles in both type 1 and type 2 fibers. Paraffin section shows strong non-specific immunoreactivity for ubiquitin in many vacuoles. Electron microscopy revealed curvilinear inclusions in the vacuoles and the myeloid bodies with lysosomal degradation produced within membrane-bound vacuoles. So, simply, the patient has abnormalities in the myofibrils seen in the muscle biopsy, and the EMG showed positive wave activity along with short duration motor unit potential. So there is myopathy seen both in EMG and in the muscle biopsy, and the patient had only 3 months duration for this condition. So, what is the diagnosis? The answer is I stressed on the problem in the presentation of the case. So the answer is hydroxychloroquine myopathy. The patient is receiving very huge amount of hydroxychloroquine for very long duration, 1000 for 20 years. So the case is hydroxychloroquine myopathy. Discussion of the diagnosis. Hydroxychloroquine is a commonly used drug for various autoimmune conditions. It is widely distributed into cardiac and skeletal muscle fibers. It is a large amphiphilic molecule that can cause both myofiber necrosis and vacuolar myopathy. It can permeate lysosome and accumulate, leading to impaired lysosomal protein degradation and accumulation of vacuoles containing membrane phospholipid and glycogen. These changes are visualized on electron microscopy as curvilinear bodies and lamellar structures called myeloid bodies. Curvilinear bodies are only seen in two conditions: neuronal ceroid lipofuscinosis and myopathy secondary to hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine. So, the picture of curvilinear bodies by electron microscope is pseudomonic for such disease, one of these diseases only, either neuronal ceroid lipofuscinosis or hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine myopathy. Large secondary lysosomes may also be present. The hydrophobic region of the hydroxychloroquine molecule interacts with membrane phospholipid, causing neutralization of phosphate group and displacement of calcium. This leads to myofiber necrosis through alterations in the plasma lemma. The findings of vacuolar myopathy, myofiber necrosis, myeloid bodies, and curvilinear bodies in isolation can be seen in other conditions and are not specific for anti-malaria toxicity. These features in combination, however, and in the correct clinical scenario may be specific for this diagnosis. So each one of these signs may not be specific for hydroxychloroquine myopathy, but the combination of all of them is specific for the diagnosis of anti-malarial toxicity or hydroxychloroquine myopathy. Neuromyotoxicity due to hydroxychloroquine is thought to be rare. It was first reported in 1965. One prospective study estimated that incidence of hydroxychloroquine myopathy is 1.9 per 1,000 patients per year. Toxicity may be more likely in patients with renal or hepatic disease, advanced age, or the chronic drug therapy, as in our case, he is taking the treatment for 20 years continuously. hydroxychloroquine may be present with paroxysmal muscle weakness and normal to mildly elevated creatine kinase level. There are few reported cases of ventilatory failure due to hydroxychloroquine myopathy. This patient was on hydroxychloroquine therapy for discoid lupus for up to 20 years. With discontinuation of the medication, he had noticeable improvement in strength 4 weeks later. Muscle strength was medical research council grade 5 over 5 in the proximal muscle, so he returned to normal. Hydroxychloroquine myopathy may be more common than previously reported and should be considered in patients on long-term therapy presenting with weakness or ventilatory failure. In these cases, muscle biopsy should be performed and the characteristic pathological findings may confirm the diagnosis. This is important. This is the conclusion of our case. Hydroxychloroquine myopathy may be more common than previously reported. It may be more common than we expect, and we should take this in consideration when dealing with patients with paroxysmal muscle weakness on chronic use of hydroxychloroquine. And this is the conclusion of our case. And finally, thank you very much for your attendance, and we will meet you tomorrow with case quiz number 105. Wassalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.